past few years, there is conception that see, whatever comes into the induction furnace, the same goes out of the induction furnace. So much quality improvement cannot be done. But now it is not a fact. The present situation is you can very much produce quality steel by melting sponge iron in induction furnace. There are, over the years, there are many technologies which have been developed by which you can easily produce thin carbon steel, low alloy steel, high alloy steel, and various grades of steel. But before I proceed to the presentation, let me introduce a little about my company where I'm working. I work with Electrotherm India Limited, which has three main divisions. First is engineering technologies. I belong to engineering and technologies. Second is steel pipe. And third is electric vehicle. In engineering and technologies division, we supply various steel making equipments that, such as melting equipments, refining equipments such as the lateral refining furnace, AOD converters, metal refining converter, casting equipment such as continuous casting machines. We also supply DRI making or sponge iron making plants along with captive power plants. We also take up turnkey projects. We also supply foundry equipments. Now, if we talk about steel making equipments, then the range becomes 10 ton and above. And foundry equipments, they vary from few kgs to almost 3 ton, 4 ton, nowadays 5 ton, even foundry furnaces are available. When we supply all these equipments, the integration of various equipments is required. So we also supply productivity improvement equipments and scrap processing equipments. And when the steel is being made, a lot of fume has been generated or the smoke has been generated. So to handle that, we also supply air pollution control system and induction heating hardening equipments also are being produced in Electrotherm India Limited. We have second division. I belong to engineering and technology division. The second division is it consists of two plants. First is steel plant and a ductile iron plant. In steel plant, the capacity is almost 0.5 million ton, where we make steel using sponge iron and scrap. And the second is ductile iron pipe, where we use the blast furnace material and we produce ductile iron pipes. The third division is electric vehicles. It all together different divisions, so I'm not discussing that. Now coming to the topic, what we will discuss here, we will first take a look what are various steel making routes and how induction furnace steel making is different than the steel making routes, or in other sense, what are various raw materials that are being used? Then what is the importance of sponge iron? What is sponge iron? How it is melted in induction furnace and how steel is produced? Because it is very important as far as India is concerned or neighboring countries is concerned. And third thing is quality steel making, because when sponge iron comes into the picture, it is one kind of impure type of scrap, you can say. We will see the composition of sponge iron. So quality steel making is very important using sponge iron. So we will also see what is the meaning of quality or what are the parameters that are required to produce quality steel. So this is the chart of various steel making routes in India. Presently, India is at world number 2 in 2019 with the production of 111 million ton per year. China is number 1 and it is producing almost 1000 million ton per annum. And in India, if we see, there are various routes. There are various three routes of steel making: BF, BOF route, arc furnace route, and induction furnace route.
Warren.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Can you lock your presentation screen share? Because it appears someone is scribbling with the share.
It is locked, Nirav.
Is it?
Yeah.
You need to be careful because it is looking like something is being scribbled here.
Okay. Okay, okay.
Right?
Okay.
Okay,
Yeah,
please carry
yeah.
on.
I can see one line on a screen. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Yes. Some lines are being drawn.
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
I understand. But it is locked. I don't know. Okay, so let us move on with the presentation. If we see the countries, Middle East, Africa, Indian subcontinent, Indian subcontinents, such as Bangladesh or say Southeast Asian countries, then induction furnace steel making is the prominent route of steel making in those countries. Now, specifically, if we see India, then there are various. Then there are three routes: blast furnace route, electric arc furnace route, and electric induction furnace route. Blast furnace is always BF-BOF. It is noted. If we see the share of these three routes, then BF-BOF route takes 46%, arc furnace takes 24%, and induction furnace route takes 30%. Now this is very important because induction for India's steel production is almost 111, and if we say 30%, then it is coming around to almost 35 million ton of steel. And when such a large quantity of steel is being produced through induction furnace, it becomes our moral responsibility that steel has to be very clean, or it has to be produced with meeting various quality norms.
Yeah, Swarin, just 1 minute. Can you go into the share and stop annotations? Check. There is an option, stop annotations. Is it visible?
Stop recording. Stop.
No. Stop annotation.
Annotate. Okay. Stop annotate.
Yeah. Yes. Now nobody will be able to scribble.
Wait a minute. It is annotate is there.
Stop annotate.
No, stop option is not there.
Okay, you continue. If things worsen, we'll do that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So again, sorry for the disturbance here in presentation, but so the point is that is why electric induction furnace is very important route, as we are producing almost 35 million. And if we see the academia, then we normally study BF-BOF route or electric arc furnace route. So that is why it is very important. Nowhere in the books, almost very few pages that come about induction furnace steel making, and this is the growing subject. So the presentation has very importance. Now, if we see what are the various products of these various routes, then blast furnace BOF route, if we consider, then it produces flat products as well as rebars. If we see induction electric arc furnace route, then majorityly it is producing flat products. If we see alloy steel, then flat products may not be there. Billets, blooms might be there, but as long as plain carbon steel is concerned, mainly it is catering to flat products. But if we see induction furnace route, then induction furnace 95 per or plus the plants, they are producing rebars or the construction quality bars. When we will move ahead with the presentation, we will see what are the quality required to produce these rebars or construction bars when we make steel using induction furnace. Now, just to take a look or to brief about the blast furnace route, then the liquid metal is coming, or the hot metal is coming out of the blast furnace. It goes to the converter. The metal is tapped into the converter. The oxygen lance is injected from the top. The oxygen is injected, and the refining takes place. The metal then goes to lateral refining furnace where degassing is done and various ferroalloys are added to meet the final chemistry of the steel that is required, and then it goes to continuous casting machine. So this is just the basic working of BF-BOF route. If we see electric arc furnace route, then sponge iron, pig iron or scrap or HBI that are melted in arc furnace with the use of this electric arcing for the sake of refining, foamy slag practice is also done, oxygen injection, carbon injection is done, and then the lateral goes to a lateral refining furnace where degassing is done. It is very important because in BF-BOF route or in electric arc furnace route, the oxygen dissolved into the bath is in the range of 850 to 900 ppm. So it is very important that degassing has to be done. And as oxygen is there in the bath, after degassing, the chemistry has to melt. So that is why the use of lateral refining furnace is very important in this plant. So that is why after LD converter or BOF, the steel goes to lateral refining furnace for treatment. And then after EAF also, steel goes to lateral refining furnace for treatment. Now, we will see induction furnace route. This is induction furnace. From the top, now you will see it is open to the atmosphere. It works on full volume condition, unlike BF-BOF or BOF and electric arc furnace where liquid metal remains only in the 30% of the furnace volume. But here it works on full volume. So no oxygen injection is possible. If it is done, the splashing takes place and liquid metal comes out. Now, how does this route works, induction furnace-based steel plants? Once the melting is over, the liquid metal is tapped into the ladle. Ladle goes to a ladle refining station. It is kept on a car and then it goes to ladle refining furnace where required chemistry adjustment is done, degassing is done, and then steel goes to continuous casting machine. This is the working, or this is how the induction furnace based steel plants work. And in many cases, you will not be able to see this lateral refining furnace, because once the induction, the steel is being made or the scrap is melted or the sponge iron is melted in the induction furnace, the oxygen dissolved is not in the range of that is 850 or 900. So it can be easily cast on continuous casting machine, and the product is a billet. So that much accuracy or that much oxygen ppm is not required in the steel. Sorry for the disturbance. Here in many plants you will not be able to see lateral refining furnace, but when it comes to quality steel making, the use of lateral refining furnace is must because see, in induction furnace, when you add sponge iron or scrap, other elements, refining means the important elements for refining are sulfur and phosphorus. In BF-BOF or in EAF, when you inject oxygen, you can take care of phosphorus. But in induction furnace, as there is no oxygen injection, it is very difficult to control phosphorus, and hence the refining of phosphorus takes place out of the furnace. Why it takes place out of the furnace, we will see in subsequent slides. Induction furnace steel making. Various materials that are used for steel making in induction furnace are steel scrap. The steel scrap can be domestic scrap or imported scrap. It can be sorted or unsorted. That is, the long pieces may come, hollow pieces may come, solid pieces may come. It can be shredded, or it can be heavy metal scrap. So various types of scraps that are available in melting in induction furnace. Next, gas-based sponge iron is also available. In India, gas-based sponge iron is not available for induction furnace. Outside also, it is very difficult to get, because gas-based sponge iron or HBI, they have captive consumption. So they have this gas-based sponge iron production plant, and next to that there is electric arc furnace. So whatever the HBI is produced, it is directly used in EAF for steel making. The another type of sponge iron that is there is coal-based sponge iron, or for the production of coal-based sponge iron, the rotary kiln technology is very popular. And in India, if we move towards eastern part, then like arc furnace, that they have this HBI production and electric arc furnace, the rotary kiln plants are supported by induction melting furnaces. So whatever the sponge iron is being produced in rotary kiln, it is directly used in induction furnace for the steel production. Now, what are the governing factors, or what are the driving forces for sponge iron to use in induction furnace? See, to run induction furnace or to produce steel using induction furnace, the main raw material we have seen is scrap. And as globally there is scarcity of scrap that is developing, or you can say more and more large number of plants that are, there is again problem with the screen.
Yeah, you need to annotate. Swaren,
yeah.
You withdraw this, do a slide share again and press and stop annotate. Go in the share. Share the slide and then press on stop annotate. Yeah, stop annotate first.
There is no option like stop annotate.
Press annotate, no?
Okay.
What does it show?
It is mouse, select, text, draw, spotlight, erase, format, clear, and save.
Annotation has to be disabled, basically.
Okay. There is no option. Okay, something happens. Can you check the screen, or can you remove
I do not have the option because you are presenting. If I was presenting, I could have controlled it.
Okay. Again, some line has come.
yeah.
Disabled participants annotation. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Fine. Things are done now. You are set.
Okay.
Please continue with the original slide. Thank you.
Okay, so use a sponge iron in induction furnace. We will see what are the driving forces. See, the induction furnace plants are coming up and the scrap scarcity is there in the world. So the root needs another raw material, or the different raw material than scrap, which will be helpful to produce steel. And that is how the coal-based sponge iron has got popularity. The countries where coal is available as a fuel, they produce steel using coal. The countries where natural gas is available to produce sponge iron, they use gas-based sponge iron. But we will see that both coal-based and gas-based, they have different chemistries. So their use, what are the limitation or what are the advantages of their use, we will see in subsequent slides. But very important thing that is governing the use of
Swaren, your voice is not audible. Swaren. Please unmute the video, please. Swaren. Swaren, am I audible? Yeah.
Yes.
Please continue. You got stuck up.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
The time is running. Okay. So the main advantage of using sponge iron in induction furnaces, there are no tramp elements and they are less polluting, because when we use steel scrap for melting, the scrap comes from various industries, chemical industries or various engineering plants where they are oily, and oil means volatiles are attached to it. So when they burn, they produce a lot of gas, a lot of smoke. But when the sponge iron is used in induction furnace for the production of steel, it directly comes from rotary kiln or it is made from iron ore. So no, these volatiles are attached or hydrocarbons are attached to sponge iron. So the melting is smokeless compared to steel scrap. Now these are the pictures of sponge iron. And first is HBI, hot briquetted iron. Second is sponge iron produced using iron ore lumps. And third is sponge iron produced using iron ore pellets. Now these are the most preferred raw materials for induction furnace. The main reason is this HBI, as they are produced from gas-based system, the carbon is very high, or during the production of HBI, there is generation of Fe3C, which increases carbon of this material. So carbon remains in the range of 1.2 to almost 2.5%, and which is very high. Mainly induction furnaces are used for construction grade steel, where carbon requirement remains in the range of 0.25%. And the use of HBI, it brings very high carbon. Even if we use self-reducing HBI, then also the carbon remains in the range of 0.4 to 0.5, which is very high compared to construction grade steel. Hence, its use is restricted in charge mix to about 40% or 50%. But if we consider this coal-based DRI, carbon remains in the range of 0.12 to 0.17%. So carbon is very low. So when we want to produce construction grade steel, you can use this material easily, the ratio being starting from 10% to 90% in the charge mix. This is the typical composition. I am saying this is the typical composition of coal-based sponge iron, where carbon remains 0.12 to 0.17. Fe metallic, the metallic part, see the sponge iron, if we see, it is produced by direct reduction of iron ore without going into the molten stage. So the composition of sponge iron contains metallic part, a little iron oxide, and the remaining gangue that is coming from the iron ore. So the composition remains carbon, Fe metallic, Fe total, because this is metallic part, and if we consider iron oxide, then Fe total is also there, and silica, alumina, other oxide, they also remain. So the typical composition remains in the range of 0.12 to 0.17% carbon, Fe metallic 78 to 83%, Fe total from 88 to 92%, SiO2 is 2% to 6%. Now, if we move ahead with SiO2, it brings the problem in melting, because SiO2 has very high melting point. So the slag that is being generated during steel making, the melting point goes up and it creates difficulty. The same with alumina. So it is very important that before we use sponge iron in induction furnace, what is its chemistry and how the melting should be done. But the important factor is, you can see phosphorus last. It varies from 0.02 to 1%. Now, 0.02, it is okay. Even if you use it 80%, 90%, the considering yield, it will not increase 0.03%. But the sponge iron, if sponge iron has 0.05% of phosphorus, then in steel making, it may go up to 0.07. Or if the sponge iron has 0.1% phosphorus, obviously it is coming from iron ore. So if the sponge iron is made from very bad quality iron ore, then from point one in steel making, it goes to the range of 0.12. Now the steel, if it is produced with phosphorus, say 0.05, 0.04%, it is not considered to be good quality steel because it has various problems like cold shortness. It brings down the ductility of the material. It brings down the toughness of the material. So normally the steel has two notorious elements, sulfur and phosphorus. But as the rotary kiln is a reduction process, sulfur can be taken care, but phosphorus cannot be removed during sponge iron production. So it is directly affecting the quality of steel, and hence it is very important when we move ahead with the quality, how do we take care of the phosphorus in steel making. Now we see this is induction furnace. This is a rotary kiln from which the sponge iron is being made. This is the product. Now you forget what is this. But to remember is rotary kiln operate with non-coking coal and iron ore. So iron ore and non-coking coal are added to the rotary kiln and sponge iron is made. Another charge material is steel scrap. Now, when we start steel making in induction furnace, the first step is to make sponge iron, it has to be liquid pool, and liquid pool is made using steel scrap. So first of all, steel scrap is added. And then once the liquid pool is formed, sponge iron is added into the induction furnace and the steel is made. So when we consider these two raw materials, steel scrap and sponge iron, first steel scrap is melted and then the sponge iron is melted. Now we see how the DRI is being melted, because the scrap is fully metallic. Once we add it into the induction furnace with the use of eddy currents, it is directly melt. But I explained, the sponge iron has Fe metallic, carbon and various other oxides. See, Fe metallic or the metallic part of sponge iron, it is melted easily with the help of induction or the eddy currents. But these oxides cannot generate eddy currents, but they are remain in the particles, the sponge iron particle, they are remain there. So thus, Fe metallic or the metallic part is melted, and with the help of conduction of the liquid metal that is formed, these iron oxides are melted. So the iron oxide or the slag is melted. So the melting of these non-metallic materials in induction furnace take place with the conduction phenomena between liquid metal and the slag, or we will say when it is fluid and solid, it is with the help of convection. So first of all, we have to melt scrap. It is melted, and when we start melting induction furnace, start melting sponge iron induction furnace, first metallic part is being melted and the liquid metal that is being formed, it helps melting these various oxides, as I explained. Now the liquid metal has FeO, because we have seen in the chemistry of sponge iron there is iron oxide. So this iron oxide has tendency to react with carbon. As we know, this it is also called direct reduction. So this iron oxide reacts with carbon and gives Fe. So that is why when we melt sponge iron, there is always increase in recovery of the metal or the yield of the metal. So how to understand this? If the scrap is being melted, it has some rusty or it has some oily. So the recovery or the yield of the scrap is almost 95%. But the sponge iron has metallic part which is 80% or say 82%. So that much metal you get. But additionally, whatever FeO is there, it reacts with carbon and it gives rise to Fe. So again, 2-3% recovery depending on the FeO in the sponge iron, the recovery goes up. So if the sponge iron has Fe metallic in the range of say 80%, recovery sponge iron is 82-83%. Whatever FeO is there, we also know Again, it is a metallurgy. If we understand the reduction phenomena of iron ore, then we see it starts from Fe2O3, then Fe3O4, then FeO, and then Fe. That is, and this is sponge iron is made with this direct reduction. So melting is not there. So little bit of FeO remains there. And when it comes to steel making, blast furnace is molten form. It has very high carbon. So FeO in slag remains less than 1%, so or say 0.2-0.3%. But here we are making steel, so carbon remains in the range of 0.2-0.3%. And we know that as the bath depletes in carbon or the carbon level goes up, the FeO in the slag goes down. The FeO in the slag goes up. The typical example, if you see or if you study the steel making slags, then FeO remains in the range of 18% to 20%. Sometimes it may go up in the range of 22%. But the important thing is carbon is very low in steel making, so FeO is high in steel making slag. What I explained previously, the same thing has been given in the table. See, if the Fe metallic in the sponge iron remains in the range of 78%, you get 81% yield. With various data that we collect from the plants or when we make steel, we do study. And from the studies, it has been observed that whatever FeO remains, one third of that FeO remains with the carbon and rest FeO goes into the slag. So if say sponge iron has almost 10% of FeO, then one third, that is 3%, reacts with carbon, and out of that almost 2 to 2.5% Fe metallic that we get into the metal. So if the Fe metallic is 78%, 2 to 2.5% increment in the yield takes the overall yield to 81%. If it is 80%, then it goes to 82%. If it is 82%, it goes to 84%. So like that. This is just a thumb rule. Actual calculations can be possible, metallurgical calculations, and you can understand what is the yield of the liquid metal, because sponge iron and scrap, they are added. So the combination of yield of scrap and the sponge iron that comes into the picture, that will all together 2 to 3 hours if I start explaining the yield of liquid metal or the sponge iron. But for the presentation, this presentation, you can understand that whatever is the Fe metallic, the yield is 2 to 3% more in sponge iron. Now the various factors that are affecting the melting of sponge iron. The first is Fe metallic. If you have good quality sponge iron or the reduction is really good, I'm not saying the metallization of your sponge iron, your iron ore quality has to be good, then you get very good reduction, degree of reduction, and then Fe metallic in the sponge iron is very high. So it will facilitate melting, it will give good melting results. Carbon in the sponge iron, see this FeO reacts with carbon. For this reaction, carbon is required, but not much, not less. So carbon, what is the carbon in the bath or what is carbon in the sponge iron? That is very important. Carbon in the bath is also very important. FeO in the sponge iron. SiO2 amount in the sponge iron. As I explained earlier, SiO2 increases the melting point of the slag, and it hinders the slag metal reaction. Because this FeO reaction, it always takes at slag metal interface. So if the slag is thick or is viscous, it will not have sufficient fluidity so that the liquid metal and slag react and you get the good recovery of your metal. So SiO2 amount is also very important. Obviously, it has to be low, less than 1% or 1% to 2%, at most 3% is okay. But if you move towards 4%, 5%, then the slag becomes very viscous and slag metal reaction becomes very sluggish. And very important, it is not a technical parameter, but it is an operational parameter, frequency of pushing sponge iron in liquid bath. See, we know the density of steel is 7.86. The density of liquid metal is 7. It is less by 10% almost. If we see the density of sponge iron, the density of particle of sponge iron, it remains in the range of 4%. The bulk density is almost 2 to 2.5. So whenever we add sponge iron into the induction furnace, it is lighter in weight. It always tries to float at the top of the induction furnace. So continuous pushing is required. There are various mechanisms by which the sponge iron is being pushed into the liquid metal. So the frequency of pushing is also very important. Then and then only the sponge iron comes into the contact with liquid metal and it enhances the melting. Sponge iron is electrically conductive, so eddy currents are generated. But when it comes with the, comes with the contact with liquid metal, it facilitates this heat transfer between sponge iron particle and liquid metal, and it makes the melting faster. So this is also very important parameter from the operation point of view. Now, as I explained, first scrap is being melted and then the sponge iron is being melted. The elements that remained into the liquid metal. Now we will see how the chemistry is adjusted when we melt these materials. So the liquid metal has the chemistry of carbon, silicon, manganese, sulfur, phosphorus, and the slag has FeO, SiO2, Al2O3. These FeO, like BFBOF arc furnace, we have gaseous FeO. We know the oxygen potential of steel making slag is considered by the amount of, or it is measured by the amount of FeO in the slag. So we can say, in other words, there is solid oxygen into the slag, that in the form of FeO. That FeO keeps reacting as per the affinity of various elements into the steel. So first FeO will react with silicon and the silicon will go. Then it will react with manganese, manganese will go, and simultaneously it will start reaction with carbon and the carbon will go. So if you are using 30-40% of sponge iron, almost your bath remains with carbon, sulfur and phosphorus. Now you know the phosphorus dephosphorization requires high basicity. It requires low temperature, that is temperature in the range of say 1570 to 1600. The CaO or the basicity has to be very high, or the slag has to be oxidizing. That means the slag should have very high FeO percentage. But here again, very funny thing, or the thing that is important to understand, is considering the cost, the induction furnaces are operated with silica rilling. Okay. And we all know that silica is acidic in nature, so you cannot add lime into it. Now, what happens if you add this magnesia, or you can do the lining with basic ramming mass or magnesia-based ramming mass or alumina-based ramming mass. But again, alumina, if we see basicity, it remains in the denominator. That if we see the formula of basicity, that is basic oxides, acidic oxides, the basic oxide remain. The basic oxides are CaO plus MgO upon SiO2 plus Al2O3. So normally alumina is considered to be neutral, but when, if we consider basicity, it remains in the denominator, or it is acidic in nature. So normally we will see in the next slide what is the effect of alumina or the basic oxides. But normally all the induction furnaces, they are operated with silica ramming mass. The operating cost remains in the range of 100-120 rupees per ton. If we consider alumina base, the cost remains 250-300. So the cost is very high. 200-300 difference in steel making is very high, because it is a volume business. The material is sold in tons. So even 200-300, the difference is considerable. So normally all the induction furnaces are used with silica ramming masses. Now, if we use magnesia instead of silica in steel making plants, then what happens? See, MgO the coefficient of linear expansion for MGO based lining, it is very high. And for the tapping, the induction furnace is made empty. It is totally empty. No liquid heat is stored into the induction furnace like it is done in electric arc furnace. And when it is empty, the upper portion of induction furnace, this portion, it comes into the contact with atmosphere and the lower portion remains hotter. And as you continuously make steel, this hot and cold atmosphere, it develops crack if we use magnesia based lining because it has very high coefficient of linear expansion. If we use alumina based lining, as I said, it is costlier. Its working has to be worked out. But again, steel making goes in the range of say 1650, 1700. The erosion becomes faster. I don't say that it is very fast, but erosion becomes faster. So the use of alumina lining is established at one or two places for construction grade steel making. And especially when where the sponge iron is being used, where the slag is violent, the erosion of alumina lining is very fast. And hence popularly silica lining is used into the induction furnace. Now we have seen the liquid metal is formed and then there is slag. Now as a metallurgist, we all know that the reactions take place at slag metal interface. And as the carbon, the FeO continuously reacts with the carbon. So if carbon depletion is there, then there is nothing for FeO to react. And hence, as we know, as a metallurgist, the FeO is universal solvent. It melts all the refractory material except MgO. But here silica lining is there. It starts reacting with silica or it starts dissolving silica as the bath depletes in carbon. And hence, with dissolution, the product is pyrolite or Fe2SiO4. And as it reacts with lining, the lining erosion, the erosion of lining is very fast. Furnace may puncture if we don't take care properly. But the result is, as the bath depletes in carbon, the lining erosion in induction furnace is very, very high. And hence, the important point or to quote is, whenever the sponge iron is used in induction furnace, it is very important to maintain the bath carbon. The bath should always have sufficient carbon so that the FeO can react with carbon and should not react with SiO2. Fine. Now, the most important thing in melting to remember is how to maintain this carbon. So the carbon can come from cast iron. It can come from high carbon scrap. There are various automobile scrap where the carbon remains in the range of 1.5 to 2%. Cast iron obviously has carbon in the range of 3%, 3.5%. So cast iron is available. It is very good. Initially melt cast iron. The carbon is there in the bath. Then you add sponge iron. That FeO reacts with the carbon of the cast iron. And by the time you keep on adding sponge iron and the furnace becomes full, you target the carbon that is required in the final composition. The next source of carbon, if scrap is also, the high carbon scrap is also not available, is cast iron is also not available, then the next source is CPC, calcined petroleum coke. They are also available in the range of say 99% carbon, 95% carbon. Of course, they have the problem of sulfur, but then you can easily stoichiometrically calculate that how much carbon you require in the bath, how much CPC you can add, and what will be the effect of sulfur. And again, you are using after induction furnace, lateral refining furnace. So you can take care of the sulfur afterwards. So there are three ways to increase carbon in the bath when you are melting sponge iron in the induction furnace. First is cast iron. Second is high carbon scrap. And third is use of CPC along with the steel scrap. Now, depending on the economics of the scrap and sponge iron, the amount of these raw materials for steel making is decided. It is not that, okay, you want to make steel, you take 100% scrap, you start melting steel and you can make steel. Or the sponge iron is available to you, so you can use sponge iron and you can make steel. No, the ratios depend on the economics of these raw materials in various parts. If I need to explain, then the northern part where the sponge iron or the iron ore is not that easily available, northern part of India, where the iron ore is not available easily and it is away from the seashore, the use of rotary kiln to produce sponge iron is not there, or the transportation of sponge iron is very costly. So if we see the northern parts of India, such as Punjab, Haryana, near to Delhi, then the more and more scrap is used and sponge iron is less. But if we move towards eastern part where the iron ore mines are easily available, that is Orissa, Jharkhand, West Bengal, then they use almost 90% of the sponge iron and hardly 10% of the scrap. It can be local scrap, it can be imported scrap, but sponge iron is easy. If we see the Maharashtra region, then Maharashtra, the seashore is very nearby and the working style is use maximum amount of scrap and very little amount of sponge iron, depending on again economics. The range may go, if there is fluctuation in the scrap rates, then there may be increase in use of sponge iron. If we see the Kutch region of Gujarat, then it is very near to seashore, though the iron ore is not available in Gujarat. But as it is near to seashore, it can import good quality iron ore, they are working in that style. So almost 70 to 80% of sponge iron is used in steel making if it is in Kutch. If we move towards south, both seashore is available, iron ore is available in near to Bellary or near to Goa, then the working style is almost used 60 to 70% of sponge iron and remaining scrap. So depending on the economics and availability of the raw materials, the ratios of scrap and sponge iron are decided. Now, it is not that you take these raw materials, you add directly into the induction furnace and you start melting. Yes, you will be able to melt the steel, but as the technology is moving ahead, it is very important that you should use a proper technology where you do efficient melting. Efficient means very low electrical energy should be utilized to make the steel. And hence, considering the same, Electrotherm has developed very efficient induction furnace. It is called DT490i. And it is developed this furnace, it is very unique into the world with the use of this digital platform, whether it is microprocessor based control is given, that is like computer, you have motherboard here. Into the power supply unit, you have only one electronic card, you have only one chip which controls all the operations of induction furnace. Fiber optics is used for signal processing and hence there is no lag between these signals. Ethernet connectivity is there. So like if there is some problem in induction furnace while you are melting, then every time service engineer has to reach, but with the use of this Ethernet connectivity, remotely the furnace can be repaired or the problem can be diagnosed. If we see the main feature, this is the screen of the digital platform furnace that is used, that is developed by induction, by Electrotherm. You can see the screen, you can see total kilowatt, what is the percentage of power that is fed, what is the voltage, what is the frequency that is going into the induction furnace. Very important feature that is introduced here is melt cycle evaluator. If you put the scrap ratios, it will decide what should be the power consumption of the steel, and it will decide, say the set KWH for the particular heat is 17,160 as you see on the screen. As it is set and you are melting, you will see totally how much KWH or the electrical energy that is going into the furnace. And if you are exceeding that, it will immediately show that you are excess consumption is almost 8 kWh per ton. See, if it is 20 ton furnace or say 50 ton furnace, 60 ton furnace, then you can see how much extra kWh has been consumed by your induction furnace. So this is very important feature. Now again, self-diagnostic or the self-fault diagnostics are also given into the in this new induction furnace, DT490i induction furnaces, which is developed by Electrotherm, that if there is any problem into your power supply unit, the engineer has to open the panel and it has to check that at in which part there is a problem. But now it will immediately take a photograph, and with the Ethernet connectivity, it will send the photograph that, see, in this section there is some problem. And again, in electronic part, it is very easy to see, because the electronic parts normally get heated. So the temperature difference can show you that where the problem can be. So here in the screen, you can see the computer or the system has rounded where the fault is. So you can immediately change the that part and you can start your production. Again, very important feature is it, when there is a problem in power supply unit, it does not reduces power to zero. It will reduce total power to say 60% to 30%, and your furnace, your production will be on. By the time you repair your furnace or you remove the fault, you can again immediately go to the 100%. So this is very advantage. Again, here left hand corner, you can see wherever the problem is there, it will indicate in red. So this is the importance of digital platform that is introduced by Electrotherm. Again, this is another problem. It has encircled the problem so that you can identify the problematic portion. See, this is a remote diagnostics lab. If there is a problem, if service engineer is not nearby, if the plant people are not able to identify the problem, you can send, you can connect the furnace remotely. Like the call centers, Electrotherm also has the service center where the 24-hour service has been given. So you can send your furnace controls to our diagnostic lab. We will identify and again the furnace can be repaired and the melting is started. See, these are the various facilities. This is very unique. And the advantage of this system is, just last week Electrotherm has commissioned one furnace by sitting here in Ahmedabad, and the furnace has been commissioned in Ethiopia, Africa. This is very important features. We have just facilitated this feature so that the customer can be benefited. And now with the time, with this corona pandemic, it has come to us as if we are remotely commissioning the furnace. So this is very good feature now where the commissioning is also can be done remotely. So these are just various features. I'm not spending much time on it. We will move ahead. We have seen the sponge iron melting. Now we will move to the quality of this steel. See, in India, the standard is IS 1786, which is denoting the production of TMT bars. So TMT bars means rebars or construction grade bar. You can see various grades. It is 500D or 550D, 550 Fe, 500D. The difference is, D stands for ductility. So the difference is between phosphorus and sulfur level. You can see 5.055, but when it comes to the grade 500D, it is 0.0, and together it has to be less than 0.015. So the grade is very stringent, where sulfur and phosphorus has to be so sponge iron as phosphorus, from where it comes from iron ore. And now, as you have melted in induction furnace which has silica lining, and hence you cannot form basic slag, you cannot do the refining in the induction furnace, Electrotherm has developed a process where refining takes outside the furnace. Because if you do lining, once the furnace full, you start refining it, it consumes additional 30-40 minutes and it leads to production loss. And hence, the refining of steel has been developed outside the furnace using the ladle refining furnace. And the name of the technology is LDFOS technology, that is electrotherm ladle dephosphorization and desulfurization. In other words, we can say the ladle refining furnace is clean steel. Again, if we see the BF, BOF or EAF based plants, there the main function of LRF is desulfurization, or if the quality is good, desulfurization is not required, then at least for degassing, because the gas remains in the range of 850 to 900 ppm, it has to be removed from the steel. Again, whatever, because of the oxygen injection, whatever the inclusions that are being generated into the steel, so those inclusions should also be floated into the slag. So the main function of ladle refining furnace or the requirement of clean steel is control of elements in terms of sulfur and phosphorus, control of gases in terms of oxygen and nitrogen, and control of these inclusions that are present into the steel. So by again purging or with calcium injection, you can allow these inclusions to float into the slag level. So by using this ladle refining furnace and with the help of this LDFOS technology, how refining or how dephosphorization takes place. See, first induction furnace, what the sponge iron and scrap is melted in induction furnace and it is tapped into the ladle. While tapping, we simultaneously add the various fluxes for dephosphorization. Then ladle goes to ladle refining furnace, where ladle is placed on the trolley, and then the ladle is tilted, slag is removed, and this trolley goes to ladle refining station. The roof is lowered, the electrodes are lowered, and normal LRF operation is being done. Now, those who are metallurgists, they can easily understand this is nothing but the double slag practice. But as melting, as steel making or oxygen steel making is not possible in induction furnace along with basicity, the oxidizing slag with high basicity is made outside the induction furnace in the ladle. Now, again, we will see how this process works. Now, you will understand it more clearly. Scrap and sponge iron are melted and they are tapped into the ladle. DFOS flux has been added to make oxidizing highly basic slag. The ladle goes to ladle refining station. The ladle placed on a trolley. It has given arrangement of tilting. So this oxidizing and highly basic slag is removed by placing ladle on a trolley and by tilting, and then this trolley or ladle car brought to ladle refining station, where arcing is started. Conventional reducing highly basic slag is made. If desulfurization is required, desulfurization is conducted, because dephosphorization has already been done using a highly basic oxidizing slag. Ferroalloys are added to meet final chemistry, and then the steel produced is sent to continuous casting machine. So this is about refining of steel in terms of sulfur and phosphorus. And as we are using conventional LRF, it has various other advantages. We will see. Now we will see the chemistry of the steel produced using this technology, LDFOS technology or induction LRF combination. See, the initial phosphorus is 0.04. After dephosphorization, it has come to 0.025. And when we add various ferroalloys, again, these ferroalloys, they contain phosphorus. So 3 to 4 points of phosphorus has increased, or if deslagging is not done properly, then phosphorus, 2 to 3 points phosphorus may get revert back. So that is why here 0.094 phosphorus, it has come down to 0.025. See the heat number one, and then the final chemistry finished is 0.029. In the same way, we can see 0.098, 0.018, and finished is 0.026. From 0.097 dephosphorization, 0.019, and by addition of ferroalloys, 0.026 from 0.091 to 0.027, 0.09 to 0.03. So these are various dephosphorization levels. In steel plant, dephosphorization is talked in terms of points. 0.001 is 1 point. So the total dephosphorization done is 69 points by addition of various ferroalloys or the defos up to billet is 65 points. And if we see desulf, then sulfur problem is not there. But as reducing slag is made in ladle refining furnace, by default, desulfurization is done and sulfur has come from 0.04 to 0.022. So these are desulf point. These are defos point, desulf point. You can see 65 to 70 point of dephosphorization is possible, and desulfurization up to 30, 40 point is possible for the production of this construction grade steel. If you want to make some special alloy, then opening sulfur remains low, opening phosphorus remains some range, and those chemistries can be adjusted. Because while working in our steel plant here in India, Kutch, we have done dephosphorization up to the level of 0.14, that is 140 point of dephosphorization has been done. Yes, 140 point, because the iron ore that we had procured, it had very high phosphorus. So when the sponge iron is being made and the steel is being made, the phosphorus was 0.150, and after dephosphorization, it has come down to 0.01 or say 0.015. So that much amount of dephosphorization is possible with this technology. Of course, as you move up and up in dephosphorization, it requires energy, it requires various fluxes to be added. So the cost changes with the amount of dephosphorization and desulfurization you want to conduct using this IF LRF combination. So
Swarin, how many more slides?
3 to 4 slides.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Yeah. So you can see the important features. First is slag chemistry. In induction furnace, as it is acid steel making, people don't look at the slag. But when it comes to refining of slag or the operation of ladle refining furnace, the slag chemistry is very important. As a metallurgist, we know very important statement that steel making is slag making. Once we develop good slag, we can do the refining of slag. But when it comes to induction furnace steel making, the statement is slightly different. It is of designing of the slag, because raw material ratios are there in your primary steel making or in your induction furnace. It is not that the fixed slag that you are making or the amount of the chemistry of the steel that is being made in induction furnace is fixed. So you have to design the slag what the chemistry you require in final metal. So the slag chemistry becomes very important, and it is covered in the LRF supplied by Electrotherm, that everything you see on SCADA, you put your chemistry, your slag composition, and the requirement of fluxes to be added for steel making, it comes on the screen. Next is optimum purging. This is very important, but as the people or the listeners might be from very big steel plants, they must be having experience of LRF operation. So I am not going into the deep of optimum purging. Next is no metal loss. This is very important to discuss, because we are making oxidizing slag outside the furnace. So oxidizing slag means FeO is there into the furnace, but still we don't have to allow metal to lose its iron into the slag. So it is very important how we restrict. Though we have to form FeO and we have to restrict this iron oxide, iron we have to restrict metal oxidation into the slag. So these are very, very, very important features that are included in ladle refining furnace supplied by Electrotherm. And the unique features are always there in ladle refining furnace, or the conventional features are 4.5 or 4 to 5 degree temperature rise, degree Celsius per minute temperature rise in induction furnace. But yes, Electrotherm induction furnaces, you definitely guess this much temperature rise. Dephosphorization is possible in ladle refining furnace. Desulfurization is possible in ladle refining furnace. Deslagging is possible, though without the use of overhead crane. Deslagging is possible, and yes, SCADA-based operation is always there. So all the controls you control, or the parameters you control by sitting in control cabin, and you make steel. With all these things, when we are making steel, we definitely develop gases or the fumes or the smokes. And induction furnace is normally melting is done in open atmosphere. There is perception that lot of pollution it takes place when it comes to induction furnace. But as the technology is developed, now it's a myth that the pollutions are there, because various systems are available to control this pollution. So here I will be running one video where you can see this is the induction furnace and this is the suction hood. And you will see how the smoke or the gases that are generated can be absorbed using this system. See, in induction furnace, melting is done and all the gases generated are absorbed into the hood that is supplied by Electrotherm. Once again, I am running this video. Maximum smoke generation is there in scrap melting time. As I explained, the scrap melting takes place in the beginning of induction furnace. Once the scrap melting is done, the sponge iron is melted, and sponge iron, as it comes directly from iron ore, the smoke generation is very low. But here you can see the scrap, and the lot of smoke is being generated and it is absorbed using this system. So the working environment is very clean. Now, to summarize this presentation, we have seen various routes of steel making and how induction furnace steel making is different than BF-BOF or EAF route of steel making, and why important is induction furnace, because we are catering to the 35% of country's steel production, and for various neighboring countries or the Middle East countries, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, this route is very important. Maximum steel is being made through induction furnace. So this is the importance of induction furnace steel making. Use of sponge iron is in induction furnace. What happens when we add gas-based sponge iron? What happens when we add coal-based sponge iron? What are the factors that are governing the melting of this sponge iron in induction furnace? What are the various lining issues? What happens if we use magnesia lining instead of silica lining, or alumina lining instead of silica lining? What are the issues that we faced? We have seen that. And the very important aspect, quality of steel. What is the quality of steel that is being made using this induction furnace LRF route? And the conclusions, finally, the conclusions that we can say, induction furnace is very useful tool to make quality steel. Even if it is plain carbon steel, low alloy steel, high alloy steel, in stainless steels also nowadays induction furnace is very popular since last 15-20 years. So it is very important tool of steel making. Rebar or construction bar steel made by induction furnace route meet the quality as that of EAF grade steel, EAF route of steel making, or electric arc furnace route of steel making, because see, induction furnace melting is done and refining is done outside the furnace. Arc furnace, you have, it is much sophisticated route of steel making. Of course, it is the capital cost is very high. It is costly route. So it is very important to make steel which is of special quality steel. So when arc furnace comes to the picture, when the same steel is being made, if we talk about construction grade steel, when the same steel is being made through induction furnace steel, so why to use arc furnace? Because it is normally costlier by 2,000-2,500 rupees per ton. So it is better to make flat products or the value added steel or the alloy steel, tool steel or the special grade steel. So it is the use of induction furnace is, it is cheaper and it is very easy to produce rebars or construction grade steel. Next, the use of DT490i furnaces, Electronom also calls it DIFOC furnaces. They are very efficient. They are, it's on a digital platform. So steel making using induction furnace has altogether gone to the different regime. That it is not a conventional steel making that you change the cards if some so problem happens, or you always go, you open the power supply unit and you check and you diagnose the problem. No, it is altogether a different platform that you see on your mobile. What is the KWH or what is the energy consumption, where the problem lies or how it can be solved, or you can give it to remote and you can easily solve the problem. You can start your production and you can you can increase the uptime of your induction furnace. The induction furnace plants are very popular, ranging from 30,000 to 1.2 million ton per annum. See, these are only possible because of the new technology induction furnace, or bigger and bigger induction furnaces they are coming into the market. Electrotherm takes up this turnkey project right from this SMS or your rolling mill, your various refining stage, all right from the construction shed. All these turnkey projects, this can be handled by Electrotherm. So one point solution is available with Electrotherm, and this is a unique blend. No other company takes this. So that is why I'm explaining this. And induction furnace steel making, if we consider only this construction grade steel, then it produces almost 2,000 to 2,500 rupees cheaper steel compared to arc furnace. So thank you friends, thank you very much for the patience that you have shown to see this webinar on sponge iron melting in induction furnace. Thank you very much. Thank you, Nirav.
Thank you, Swarin, Dr. Swarin. Thank you very much. Now we would come down to a couple of questions that people have asked.
Okay.
Is there any mechanism to check the chemistry of melt?
Oh, spectrometer.
Auto mechanism to get.
Yeah. Very good question. But unfortunately, online spectrometers are not available, that the melting is going on into the furnace and you can directly see the chemistry. Those systems, those mechanisms are not available. You have to collect the sample and you have to send it to the spectrometer lab. Yes, you can install or you can replicate the screen of spectrometer directly on your pulpit of induction furnace steel making. That once the spark is given onto the sample, you can directly see the chemistry in your pulpit. But online chemistry measurement is not available.
Okay, thank you. Another question is from Mr. ANR, is that what is the cycle time reduction of the furnace of Electrotherm as compared to the electric arc furnace EF?
Okay, see, if we compare, it is altogether 2 to 3 hours a different lecture, but modern arc furnaces are with UHP, ultra high power. So the melting point, a melting cycle varies from 35 minutes to 55 minutes. And lot of, along with high power, lot of chemical energies are introduced into the arc furnace. So one is electrical energy. Second is your oxy fuel burners. Third is you are doing foamy slag practice. So a lot of chemical energy and electrical energy is there. So with this, you can reduce this simultaneously injection of these energies take place in arc furnace. But in induction furnace, there is only electrical energy that is utilized to melt. So arc furnaces where the range of melting can be from 35 to 55 minutes. In induction furnace, it varies from say 70 minutes to 90 minutes. And with sponge iron, it will again go up by 15-20 minutes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Second question is Mr. Ashish Ranjan Gaonkar. He has asked, is there any problem of moisture contact as the top of the induction furnace is open?
No. There is no moisture contact because when induction furnace is used continuously, the top is though colder, it comes into the contact with atmosphere, but the temperature remains in the range of 1200-1300 degrees Celsius and the bottom remains 1600 degrees Celsius. So even if the moisture is there into the atmosphere, it cannot enter into the induction furnace.
Okay. One question is from Mr. Khalid Al-Hadidi is, what is the power consumption and the melting rate?
Yeah, see, again, they are relative. They varies with induction furnace size for steel making and the size varies from 10 ton to 60 ton. So if in between, if we consider 20 ton induction furnace with 100% scrap, then power consumption may vary from 525-30 kWh per ton. If we use 50-60% scrap, the power consumption may go up to 590 or 610 kWh per ton. But again, if we increase the furnace size from 20 ton to say 40 ton, here what is 525, it will become 515 to 510. So the kWh per ton energy consumption will go down as the furnace will go up. And again, yes, kWh per ton, again, it varies with the amount of sponge iron.
Yeah. Okay. Second, another question is from Mr. Abhinav Bansal. Is if using CPC, is there a difference in steel making process as with pig iron?
Yes, of course. Very good question. See, when we start melting sponge iron, initially we have to melt, as I said, high carbon material. So cast iron, when we melt, the carbon is already there into the metal. It is dissolved into the metal. But if we don't use cast iron and we use steel scrap along with CPC, then initially carbon has to go into the solution. So that energy is endothermic. So energy consumption is there. When the carbon goes from solid condition to the solid solution with steel to increase the bath level, the carbon level of the bath. So the energy consumption, if we compare by melting cast iron and by melting scrap plus CPC, so scrap plus CPC will consume more energy compared to cast iron melting.
Okay. Second, another question is Mr. Dr. T.R. Vijay Raman. He is asking, scrap is better or sponge iron is better to produce quality steel in this route?
Okay. As I explained, it depends on economics. See, if I am in a Punjab or upper part of India and I am transporting sponge iron, it will increase the cost of transportation by 3 rupees or 4 rupees. So in eastern side, in Raipur, if sponge iron is available at say 16 rupees per kilo, in Punjab it will be available at a rate of 19 rupees a kilo. So use of sponge iron and cast iron is relative, that how much amount we have I should use by melting, for melting of this. So I cannot directly say that what is beneficial, but yes, our consumption is definitely low in scrap melting compared to sponge iron melting.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Soren, for there are any more questions. And I request everyone to kindly email your queries directly to Dr. Soren. His email ID is swaren.bedarkar@electrotherm.com, swaren.bedarkar@electrotherm.com. So herewith, I thank you, Swaren, and I would also like to share one more information about tomorrow's. And we have a presentation tomorrow by just please hold on. 3D printing during COVID-19 pandemic is talked by Professor Sundar Atre. So Atre is director of additive manufacturing at the Institute of Science and Technology at the University of Louisville, USA. And tomorrow is his talk at evening at 7:30 to 9 p.m. Indian time. The login ID and password will remain the same as meeting. And since we are continuing it with a webinar series, we are all are requested. Thank you, everyone, for just time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Was I audible? Yeah.
No, your voice. So,
thank you very much. Yeah, thank you very much for this talk, and many participants have communicated their compliments on their talk, and we look forward to a future interaction as well, Dr. Swaren.
Thank you all participants.
We end this meeting right now. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.